This is the Breaker.news podcast for the week of January 14th, 2024. I'm Bob Mackin, publisher of theBreaker.news and host of the Breaker.news podcast. Welcome to edition number 325. The Breaker is your source for news, opinion, and analysis about British Columbia issues, institutions, and influencers. Later, I'll tell you how you can support The Breaker. On this edition, headlines from the Pacific Rim and the Pacific Northwest, I award a virtual Nanaimo bar to a difference maker, and on the Big Deal feature, I welcome back Jim Mullin, host and producer of Krown Gridiron Nation on TSN and president of Football Canada. Jim is back with The View from Bowen Island. This is the Big Deal feature on the Breaker.news podcast. Time again for The View from Bowen Island. Joining me from Bowen Island, British Columbia, the little paradise and how sound, is Jim Mullin, who's the producer and host of Krown Gridiron Nation on TSN, and he's also the president of Football Canada. And before we get to some football talk, this Arctic outbreak, how are people on Bowen keeping warm?
Probably by sitting behind their keyboards and comparing the weather and complaining to each other on Facebook sites. Island-oriented Facebook sites. You know, the first day that this broke out, Monday, that would be the night of the college football final. We had a snowfall here. There was no snow in the area where I'm in. I'm in Eagle Cliff, and if you can look behind me there, you might be able to make out a ferry going back and forth. That's Horseshoe Bay just behind me there. So we're on this pocket on the east side of the island, towards the north side of the island, so northeast side of the island. Lots of Arctic outflow here that comes down Howe Sound. We can actually see where off Passage Island, where the winds out of Howe Sound meet the southeast flow. Actually, we can see a lot of weather fronts meeting each other out here. And when they were talking about the threat of a waterspout, we were looking at some of the unfriendly clouds and seeing how they were scraping down towards the water, and we were in fear of one just yesterday. But getting back to that Monday, no snow in this area. All I had to do was travel about a kilometer and a half, and there was snow over in the Scarborough area on the way to the Cove. And it was a little greasier by the time we got to the Cove. We never really received snow here in that first 24 hours of snow or so. There was about this much, and it was really icy snow, like literally country blocks wise, five blocks that way. So, you know, because Cyprus is behind me here, because we have mountains here, we're literally off two lee sides. And in this little area, we've got about this island that's about the same size as Vancouver proper. I'd say it'd be safe to say that we've got about six different climate zones here. Mm. So when we received, you know, information on Facebook and pictures on, you know, there's a Bowen Island road update site, depending on where you are, you either had this much snow or you're over in Eagle Cliff with us going, just like somebody in Vancouver usually does when it snows on the other side of the Rocky Mountains. So, that's how Bowen's been handling it. Usually the main roads are kept really well. There's school bus routes, and everything's usually passable here on the main roads. I certainly wouldn't want to live up a cliff over some of those roads that spiral up a 20 to 22% grade, because you're leaving your car at the bottom and then you're sliding down a hillside to get to it at the end of the day.
One thing that you keep a close eye on because of your presidency of Football Canada is the comings and goings in football. Down south, a week of blockbuster coaching moves south of the border after the end of the NFL regular season, after the end of the NCAA Bowl Championships. Two of the longest serving and most successful coaches out there are out. Pete Carroll from Seattle and Bill Belichick from New England. And from Alabama, Nick Saban retired and Late news on Friday that Kalen DeBeer from Washington, University of Washington, the runner-up in the national championship, is going to Alabama to replace Nick Saban. I don't know if there's ever been a week like this at all in any sport in North America at all, let alone football.
Well, in Seattle, what a way to cap things off after that disappointing national championship to lose the head coach of the Huskies. Especially to a program like Alabama. But if you see one thing in common with Carroll and Belichick and Saban, the writing was on the wall for these guys. They're either 71 or 72. And, you know, when in an era where head coaches are consistently getting younger into their 30s, it's not the football that we grew up with, but, you know, coaches become coaches because they've been studying the game all of their lives, and so to have coaches in their late 30s, early 40s is starting to become the norm, because it takes that much energy and that much dedication to stay on top of your craft. And you know, hats off to the three of them. I think they can all be talked about in about the same breath for the same reasons. Actually, the bridge between Belichick and Saban is really a Pete Carroll, who had outstanding results at USC. He got out of USC just in time after a scandal rolled through there and moved to the Seahawks a dozen years ago. Made sure that the Seahawks won a Super Bowl, so you couldn't call them the Seattle Mariners of football anymore. The one thing about Pete Carroll that really stands out to me on a personal level and a regional level, you know, a few years ago, this just before the pandemic, this is in the off season, there was a rugby style tackling course that was taught up here in the Fraser Valley area, and on his own time, Pete Carroll, to contribute back to football, showed up at it and participated in it here, just because the guy lives and breathes and loves football, and it is his life. And I think you could probably say the same about the other two too. You know, when you look at Nick Saban's background, here's a guy that, you know, maybe did a few things that, you know, that rankled a few people when he arrived in Alabama, but he ended up respecting the traditions at Alabama and brought some of his own traditions in there that have become Alabama traditions. And when it comes to defending his athletes, his student athletes, even after they graduate, he's there to speak up for them as well. I think the thing that Belichick will be remembered for, you know, it, besides the wins and besides the Super Bowls, is the revolutionary stance that he took in terms of putting athletes on the field instead of football players on the field. How speed and agility in all positions was paramount to him, and how that changed the game, and how that for defenses really took away a field from offenses that face them. So, you know, there's similarities and differences. I'm sure there's a fun Venn diagram that somebody's drawing up right now where the three of them cross over in a humorous punchline. I haven't thought of it yet. But you know, they share stuff in common, but they share stuff in part as well. And they've left an indelible mark on the sport of football stateside.
With Pete Carroll being this vaguely described advisor, or in this vaguely described advisor role, and I'm going to put this out there, I'll be either very wrong or very right, but what happens if the successor does not pan out, and that the team gets off to an 0-3 start in 2024 or worse? Does Pete Carroll come back mid-season, or does his successor get to coach out the whole season and Pete Carroll comes back in 2025? I mean, is that a possible scenario?
Well, I think when Bill Belichick announced that he was leaving, he was also advising the New England Patriots. And I think for both of these professional coaches, they will have a hand in selecting the next coach of the organization. And if you want to compare it to the BC Lions, Wally Buono had a hand in selecting Mike Benavides, right? So take away from that what you want. I think the coaching pool available to CFL teams is a whole lot more limited than what you experience in the United States, you know, especially at the Division I and the NFL level. But I think both of them will definitely have a hand in picking their successor. And you know, at the stage of life they're at, I believe Bill Parcells, when he left, he was approaching his early 70s as well. And when he was out, he was out. So I think that you know, certainly there will be a transitional process. But you know, there, you know, when you take a look at a guy like Pete, who, you know, I refer to as Positive Pete, because he is so positive in his delivery. There could still be like television in his future. Certainly it won't be in Hoodie's future. It might be in Nick Saban's future. You know, I think there's a life in football, but I'm not sure if it's coaching for any of these three.
Now, before we get to some political football and some predictions for 2024, the Vancouver Canucks are contenders in January. What do you think of what Rick Tocchet has been able to do almost a year after taking over this team from Bruce Boudreau?
Well, you know, as beloved as Bruce Boudreau was in this community, and as much as people rallied to his defense when the Aquilinis cut him loose in the way that they did, and as much as Rick Tocchet rolled into that situation not on his forward foot because of all these circumstances outside of his control, he's obviously the right guy for this team at the right time. And I do think it speaks to his ability to match a system with the talent that he has on hand, to create better special teams than Boudreau certainly could, better positional play. You know, right across the board, Tocchet's the right guy for the right time here. Whether a team of this vintage will not have the clock strike midnight early in the playoffs, we'll wait and see on that. They're on a bit of a Cinderella ride right now, but you know, this in the new NHL over the last 10 to 12 years or so, this isn't the first time we've seen a team from the lower echelons jump up to the penthouse in the space of a year, and I think that speaks more to the parity and the competitive nature in the NHL rather than having true sad sack teams that we probably grew up with that were perpetually sad sack teams. There's no Oakland Seals in the NHL right now. The San Jose Sharks will be competitive in a couple of years. I can guarantee you that. These are all run as professional businesses now, not flying by the seat of their pants. So if the opportunity exists for the Canucks right now, take advantage of it, because you never know when your fortunes are going to turn the other way.
Predictions for 2024, one bit of news that's happening up your way in Howe Sound, the West Vancouver Sea to Sky MLA, Jordan Sturdy, who's been elected multiple times as a BC Liberal, and of course the BC Liberals rebranded in 2023 as BC United. He's announced he's retiring. He's not going to run again for the legislature.
Well, when the government is one way and the seat is another way, it's always an uphill battle. You know, I will say that as much as the government has their limited reach over BC ferries, and as much as there have been some challenges, you know, within BC Ferries in terms of staffing and cancellations and other items, you know, we still have a fairly good service here, and I think Jordan Sturdy can take some credit for that. But you're always going to have a limited scope as an MLA when you're sitting in the opposition benches, and there's and you just don't have that crossover outside of committee with the reigning party. So probably an uphill battle over the last little while for him. I can understand why after years of service he's he's ready to move on to other things. I also think that when you take a look at the disastrous rebrand of the political party that sounds like a Division II soccer team in Canada, it's cleared way for a lot of uncertainty here. And the, you know, you would think that the going into this election that the biggest race would be who would capture that nomination for BC United. I think the biggest race now is who's going to define themselves in this province as the choice of the center right. And, you know, you can see it play out here. There's educated voters here. They can tell the difference between the Conservative Party and BC United. I think they'll have the edge here. But you know what? There's going to be some leakage. I'm interested to see how with local polling, which there isn't a lot of, plays itself out here. I don't think it'll be enough of a split between the two of them for the NDP to come up the middle in this area, as much as there's probably support up that way towards Squamish, and there's probably a fair bit of Green Party support here on this island. I think it's, I actually think there's a possibility it could be a two-way battle here, but we'll wait and see if Kevin Falcon and BC United try to rebrand the rebrand, so to speak, because it's been a disaster. It's New Coke. It's the New Coke of politics.
Yeah, indeed. That election is scheduled for October of this year, although Premier David Eby could always go sooner. He says he's going to stick to October, that there's a lot of unhappiness with the healthcare system, the education system, transportation. We're constantly seeing problems at overpasses. Luckily, Bowen has no overpasses where trucks can hit. over on the mainland,
you've had people crash into the deck here before and delay ferries for a day. So
it doesn't seem as if the NDP is getting things in order. But then again, there's no one else that seems to be ready for governing at this moment.
No, I think you can probably say that right across the spectrum, be it the federal race that is pending in the future, and to a great degree, the province right now. I'm not sure if there's anyone out there with a big idea to take into an election cycle right now. I haven't seen them define it. And you know, the lead subjects that you talked about, which are immigration and housing, which now are obviously tied together economically, are you know, housing is something that you go back to federal conservative governments not building enough social housing, and then the current Liberal government and the NDP Liberal arrangement that's in Ottawa right now. We're now trying to scramble to catch up, but weren't ahead enough of the curve. There's plenty of blame to go around on housing, and especially not jumping in and addressing the issues that we had on foreign investment in housing, you know, up to 15, 20 years ago. The one thing about BC is all the problems in housing in this country, we felt it first and we could see it coming. And there was, as John Q Public, as a common citizen, there was very little that we could do about it. Certainly during a Liberal government in Victoria. And I'm not sure how much the NDP has really slowed things down in this regard, or has really understood the forces around housing. So there's certainly a lot of challenges right across the board between all of these parties. I don't think they're offering solid solutions right now. I don't think they're offering big ideas, and I do think they are subject to some key decisions that are being made at the federal level or even at the Bank of Canada level with interest rates. So you group those in. Those are issues that they don't have control of: inflation, interest rates, immigration, that all lead into housing. Housing, they have some control over it, of course. I think one of the simmering topics sitting there for the NDP is something that once again was initiated from the feds, is this zoning issue. The idea that communities 10,000 and larger, you don't necessarily have to give much mind to zoning rules that were in place, and you can put up a fourplex where there used to be a single family home. There's going to be tension in communities over that, and there's going to be flare-ups over that. I understand the density that's required around transit stations and hubs to that effect, but in these other communities where you can ignore the will of neighborhoods and the culture that exists within a community and turn your back on years of planning around density, there's going to be issues, and it's going to go to court, and it's going to be tense. Probably maybe not as silly as what we've seen with the Surrey Police RCMP piece, which is turned into a sad comedy, but it's going to become an issue this year. I think it's an issue that folks haven't been paying attention to much because it hasn't manifested itself in your backyard. But when it gets in your backyard, you might be saying that you don't want it there.
And to bring it back to your backyard to complete the circle, Bowen Island has seen some friction over different factions, people that want some more development, that want some more tourists, that want to turn a regional park into a campsite, and others who want to keep it the way it is and to protect the environment on Bowen Island. That debate flared up in 2023, and there were a lot of questions about governance on Bowen, whether it's the Municipal Council or Metro Vancouver as a whole. What is going to happen in 2024 with that question?
On the campsite piece, I wouldn't say it's as much environmental as it is just about managing resources. Introducing 100 campsites on the opposite end of the island away from the ferry, even though they say there aren't going to be cars coming onto the island, is going to disrupt basic ferry services. We can't handle it. It's as simple as that. If you want to put a second boat on when that campsite is open, maybe that's where the conversation can start. But as Bowen has grown over the years, people in search of affordable housing have come here and still remain connected to the lower mainland and use that ferry as a device to commute. So if it is a lifeline for a number of people on this island, to compromise it for overnight campsites is really short-sighted by Greater Vancouver, and is certainly a piece where I think there's money attached to it that makes it easier for Bowen Council to digest. But I don't. But when you talk to people on this island, it's pretty well against the idea of camping on this island. Now, in terms of development on the island, look, we're in the middle of winter right now, and out of four stages, we're still on stage three water restrictions where we are. We were on stage four in June of last year. The infrastructure that we have here just simply isn't in place to sustain more growth, and we're growing anyway. So we have water stands here, we don't even have fire hydrants. If a house or two goes up, we could be in real trouble in any one of these neighborhoods across the island. So we're on various water systems. They were set up originally as private water systems. We don't have a single water system on this island. Water is a, and access to it is a major issue. and to believe that we can grow exponentially and turn this into a Mercer Island rather than a Bowen Island is extremely short-sighted, because we don't have the resources to grow here right now, and we don't have the infrastructure here to grow. So the infrastructure has to be here and be in place before we start to grow, which seems to be an issue right across this country right now in terms of housing, immigration, all those bigger issues that we're talking about in regard to the provincial election.
My guest, Jim Mullin, Bowen Island resident in Howe Sound, British Columbia, the producer and host of Krown Gridiron Nation on TSN and the president of Football Canada. Thanks again for joining us on the Breaker.news podcast.
Thank you, Bob.
Time on the Breaker.news podcast for Around the Rim. We look at news headlines around the Pacific Rim. In the Taiwan news, Chen Shui-bian shares cryptic image ahead of Taiwan's January 13th election. Former president's homemade meme with motto similar to TPP campaign slogan confuses some netizens. The post includes an image of a large eyeball wearing a suit and top hat, with a green frog pasted over the figure's shoulder, alongside a cropped image of Chen, who is in the corner with a small stuffed figure of a baseball player. The text, "Taiwan's Choice," is at the top of the picture. When asked what meaning the image of the eye and frog was meant to convey, Chen simply said, quote, "It's a meme." In Kyoto news, Putin may visit disputed islands off Japan's Hokkaido. Russian President Vladimir Putin on Thursday pledged to visit a chain of islands in its Far East, including those disputed with Japan, further complicating their strained ties amid the ongoing war in Ukraine. Russia contends that the chain of islands includes four that are claimed by Japan. The four are called the Northern Territories in Japan and the Southern Kuriles in Russia. In the Hong Kong Free Press, Hong Kong police take mother of wanted U.S.-based activist Francis Hui away for questioning. Hui's mother was not arrested, but the family home was searched, according to sources who spoke to Hong Kong Free Press. Hui, the first high-profile activist from Hong Kong to be granted political asylum in the U.S., is one of 13 activists wanted by Hong Kong police for alleged national security offenses and for whom a $1 million Hong Kong dollar bounty has been offered. That's Around the Rim on this edition of the Breaker.news podcast. Now it's time on the Breaker.news podcast for Cascadia Calling. We look at news headlines around the Pacific Northwest. In the Oregonian, computer chip maker announces furloughs at Oregon factory days after landing $72 million from feds. Microchip Technology also locked up $11 million in state funding for the same project. Microchip said the furloughs don't change the company's plans to expand the Oregon factory, but reflect short-term issues related to customers' inventory backlogs. Microchip said it isn't cutting any jobs. In the Seattle Times, Alaska Airlines Flight 1282 passengers sue Boeing after 737 MAX 9 blowout. On Thursday, six passengers on Flight 1282 and a family member of one of those passengers filed a proposed class action lawsuit in King County Superior Court in Seattle against Boeing, claiming they are owed compensation for injuries sustained during the incident. The Alaska Airlines flight was operating a Boeing 737 MAX 9, the less popular of two MAX models currently carrying passengers, when a piece of fuselage broke loose at around 16,000 feet in the air. The refrigerator-sized hole in the aircraft caused the cabin to rapidly depressurize. In the Times Colonist, special delivery, helicopters and internet bring creature comforts to lighthouse keepers. It takes time and planning, but keepers can get almost anything delivered to their remote locations. The Coast Guard manages 28 staffed lighthouses on the BC coast, stretching from Green Island near the Alaskan Panhandle down to Trial Island off the shores of Oak Bay. Each has a keeper or two, and there are alternates who take over for designated periods when regular keepers need to reconnect with civilization. That's Cascadia Calling on this edition of the Breaker.news podcast. It don't matter what color you are, 'cause love will conquer hate, so you won't stand alone, you won't stand alone.
brought to you by Spruce Hill Contracting.
Every week we end the Breaker.news podcast on a tasty note by awarding the goodness of a virtual Nanaimo bar to people making a difference. A virtual version of the province's favorite dessert bar goes this week to Crime Stoppers. January is Crime Stoppers Month in BC. The BC Hotline feeds police 11,000 tips a year, helping solve violent and white-collar crimes in communities big and small. Check out bccrimestoppers.com. You can nominate someone for a virtual Nanaimo bar. Send me an email to bob@thebreaker.news. Spruce Hill Contracting, custom homes and renovations. Find more information at sprucehill.ca. That's it for the Breaker.news podcast for the week of January 14th, 2024. I'm Bob Mackin. Thanks for joining me. Did you know that on the 14th of January in 1973, the Miami Dolphins completed their perfect 14-0 season with a 14-7 win over the Washington Redskins in Super Bowl VII in Los Angeles? Now you know. Send me your feedback. Send me your story ideas to bob@thebreaker.news. Bookmark thebreaker.news. You can also find us at thebreaker.ca. Sign up for the free email newsletter and get updates to your inbox. And follow The Breaker News on X, formerly known as Twitter, as news happens. And you can support The Breaker for as little as $2 a month. For more information, go to patreon.com/thebreakernews. That's patreon.com/thebreakernews.
Until next week.